Thousands of years, philosophers and poets have told mankind that there is more inside. That the reality of the external world is only one of millions of realities within the human nervous system. For thousands of years, too, men have studied methods of consciousness expansion, techniques for going out of your mind. Chemicals are perhaps the most effective method, because the language of the body, the language of the nervous system, is itself biochemical. Another form of direct energy which can produce the psychedelic experience is music. Energy vibrations artfully energized to take us into new dimensions of space, time, and identity.
Psychedelic Countdown, the Seeking a Thread Psychedelic 100, wrapping up, but the penultimate episode here. I am Dom, if you didn't know. We're counting down numbers 20 to 11 in my top 100 favorite psychedelic records. As a reminder, these are all records I own, records only. This list could be completely different in 5 years, well, maybe not completely, but there could certainly be some additions if I have my way. And there's certainly some things I would love to have that aren't here, but are not. So we move forward, and this is what the list is, and it lives on now. So gonna get into it here in just a sec. Again, I know it's been a few weeks, but I plan to finish this thing up. You know, certainly, you know, in June will probably be the last episode. So yeah, let's get into this thing, because we are in the top 20 of my top 100 psychedelic records, and I'm going to try to insert some more sort of personal touch on this one, just in terms of where I heard these records and what was going on in my life, so that'll be a little feature of this episode. So let's get into it. I'll tell you what we're listening to when we get to it, or sort of, anyway. Number 20, the second record in the list by Mr. Syd Barrett, the Madcap Laughs, the first record from 1970, but recorded as early as 68 and 69 as he was breaking down in Pink Floyd. This is the second Harvest UK boxed EMI, but with very early pressing. Here's the original gatefold, you know, Mr. Barrett. You know, this is him, you know, still writing songs, but becoming difficult to work with, and as a result was ousted from Pink Floyd, not picked up, as the story goes. But Roger Waters, Doug Gilmour, there's a hockey reference for you, David Gilmour, still very much indebted to him and felt as if they wanted to help him along, and the Madcap Laughs was as a result. Members of Soft Machine on here, Ratledge, Robert Wyatt, and is Kevin Ayers? No, I don't think Kevin Ayers is actually on this, but it's Ratledge, Wyatt, and Q Hopper, I guess? Forgetting. The cover done by Hypnosis, a cover shot. This is in Syd Barrett's flat. Various producers, but Gilmour and Waters are really the ones who take the credit here. You know, it was recorded in this, recorded, and the musicians that were recruited very much had to play and follow him, not so much play with him. He was really, and as you listen to this record, it does feel as though no one knows what's going to happen next, maybe even Syd Barrett. But it's just a magical record and certainly an acid folk album. I mean, I don't, you know, that's not sort of what he was making. This is truly a man who was an acid casualty trying to, you know, keep it together and write songs and produce them. Essentially, these are like solo performances just with the members playing and sort of trying to keep up. But just some beautiful songs on here. I love Dark Globe, has always been sort of my favorite.
Please lift a hand, I'm only a person whose armbands beat on his hands hang tall. Won't you miss me? Wouldn't you miss me at all?
Golden Hair, which is like a James Joyce, I think, if I remember correctly. The lyric, or the words are by James Joyce. The lyric of Golden Hair is from a poem by James Joyce. The Madcap Laughs is super, it's dark, but lovely. You know, there's certainly some sort of angular moments with like No Good Trying and No Man's Land. And it's some, you know, sort of like some whimsy too. You know, I like this false start. It kind of feels like you're almost like a fly on the wall on this one. I think this being, you know, along with Barrett, both records deserve to be in the top 100. I first heard this, well, it sort of has something to do with hearing the first Pink Floyd record. At some point I just started discovering and digging into some of the sort of records around that. And I frankly don't remember when I first heard this. For years I've had the CDs and I still have them. And I got this not too long ago, but not recently. I don't know, somewhere within the last 5 years. So I had a more recent reissue. So number 20, Madcap Laughs, Syd Barrett. I'm sure many of you will agree. A wonderful record. Okay, number 19. This one, I'm not a Grateful Dead fan, but this is the sound of the band. This is kind of what I would like the Grateful Dead to be, and it sort of is, does sound like them in somewhat, but it's coming from a more rural, sort of like singular, sort of almost private press sort of atmosphere. And it's relatively clean rivers, and absolutely magical, I think I said magical before, transcendent rural psych record from 1975. Now, this is from the mind of Phil Perlman. A musician, very much a true hippie in the sense of the word. He was like a peaceful, you know, loving, spiritual person. Very like a true hippie, and not, I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean like someone who was truly a peaceful person and wanted to make sort of music that had not a commercial appeal, but sort of artistic. And that's where this record came in. That's what we're listening to, Beat of the Earth. Completely improvised music. This is a bootleg, a very, very rare album. It's on his own Radish imprint, I believe it is. And then he would also follow it up with The Electronic Hole, which is a little more song-oriented, but still pretty loose and wild. So that's what we're listening to. The Beat of the Earth is great. It's all just this long-winded sort of spiritual, artistic happening. And that's sort of what they call it. This is, like I said, there's probably only 500 of these. And Phil Perlman, who's now a goat farmer, may be in possession of some of these, but he would go away for a while, become a farmer, and then make this record. And this, I first saw at the WFMU Record Fair in probably 2009 or 2010. I saw it and I was getting into psych or gotten into psych, and I saw this on one of the sellers, one of the dealers' sort of wall, easel wall. Now, I didn't know what it was at all, but I was like, that cover is drawing me in, and it really does. This is the Phoenix reissue. I came close to, well, I thought I was, well, there was a seller who had a copy up for sale, but it turned out to be a scam, and I almost sort of went for that. But in any case, absolutely top shelf rural psychedelia. Phil Perlman, really an art student, was really really collaborating with a few people here and making this record that it feels shambolic and loose, but the songs are there. There's definitely a bedrock of good songs on this record. It's a grower, though. It is one of these growers. You really gotta give it a few listens and it starts to seep in. There's definitely sort of tape effects and sort of some trippy atmospheres, but the songs themselves are sort of in the Grateful Dead mold. 1,000 copies were pressed? Yeah, I just some other notes. Very surf-esque, like acid, sort of like beach vibes, sort of Middle Eastern a little bit. It's self-titled, 75, released on his own Pacific. I think it's just Pacific was the name of it. And apparently he's been living off original copies that he has, that many are warped, but he releases them every now and then, Perlman, and sells them for top dollar. He knows what they're worth now. But yeah, there's certainly a vibe of like sort of Armageddon on this, End of Days. But I just can't emphasize how good the songs are. I mean, it just grips me every time. An interesting sort of side note is his oldest son, Adam, ended up converting to Islam and is actually, I think, one of the first Americans to be tried as a traitor. And there's definitely stories about him. His name is Adam. He became a member of Al-Qaeda, apparently. So that's Phil Perlman's son, so sort of a sore topic there. But yeah, just this, you know, an Orange County-based art student, like doing a true hippie record that just wonderfully molds country rock, folk, Middle Eastern, psychedelia, experimental, and just an incredible album. Rural, relatively clean rivers, self-titled with that magical artwork. If you don't know this one, the Phoenix reissue is sort of in and out of print. It's a boot, so it's the only way to really get this. I don't know if it'll ever be properly reissued, but there is an archive of someone who's, I'll post the link to it. I forget who the writer is. They were involved with the Acid Archives, maybe. But they've worked with Perlman and have like properly mastered digital tracks with all the artwork and everything. I'll link to that below. That's sanctioned by Phil Perlman himself. But as far as official vinyl reissue, I don't know. I don't know if the tapes exist, so. That's it, number 19. Number 18, some records I touched on, or a record I touched on recently.
Deshalb machen wir Musik.
Ralph and Florian by Kraftwerk. This is the long Kraftwerk record that is in the list. 1 and 2 could be in there. I just feel like and I love 1 and 2. I feel as far as when it comes to Kraftwerk, this is like the ultimate sort of summation of this band. And This is them transitioning into what they've become, the electronic sort of superheroes, but, you know, coming off the psychedelic rock that they were doing as in early on and figuring out their instruments and learning to work with them. And you can see them here in the studio. I believe this is what would become Kling Klang, their studio. This is from 1973. This is the Virgin... The Vertigo US copy, and then, as I said in the last Kraftwerk video I did, this is the Vertigo UK original on the Spaceship label. So, there's that. Wolfgang Flohr joined the band with Ralph and Florian, though he's not on this record. This is truly them. It's just so spacious and lovely, cosmic. It really hits you hits me in all the right spots. Connie Plank producing, you know that's a trademark quality. It's just, again, it talks a little bit, you know, and the vocals start to creep in on this, by the way, that you start to hear that vocoder. There's actually a sort of vocal that Panda Bear samples on Person Pitch, his breakout record, or his most famous record and a masterpiece in itself. Less chaos than the Kraftwerk 1 and 2. It is sort of more streamlined, but just super mind-altering. You know, absolutely special. Florian Schneider, of course, passed away, a couple years ago, and Ralph Hütter was quoted as saying, this record and the first two, that's like their archaeology. Or he thinks of this music as archaeology, like it's just so old that no one cares, or... It's meant to be a sum of the parts to create what they would become. But as far as reissuing these records, they have not been reissued since the 70s. There was one time they reissued them in the late 70s. Everything else after that is a bootleg, including all the CDs. So, I don't know. These Ralph and Florian and 1 and 2 deserve proper treatment, and it should get there. Of course, this was them coming off of those two records that they did, both with Connie Plank, I believe. One had... Klaus Stinger of Neu on it, on number one, and of course they were Organization before that. But I just think this is the absolute masterpiece by Kraftwerk. Ralph and Florian, 1973 on Vertigo, and soon to transition to what, Capitol in the U.S. and I don't remember in Germany. I don't have any German other than 1 and 2 originals of the everything else. The famous Kraftwerk records, I have US originals. So yeah, there's that Spaceship label again. Anyway, I've already shown that. Kraftwerk, Ralph and Florian, number 18. Number 17, a record I referenced in some comments. I forget why it came up, but this is a Private Press masterpiece. Woe Ye Demons Possessed. Not a lot of information on this. It is a private press, and it's mainly instrumental. There's a few trancey vocals, but it's done by Maurice Robertson and Walter Burns, who never really did anything other than a 1987 cassette, which actually is quite rare. And that's under the Burns and Robertson imprint, name. But this is, if you could call something American krautrock, that's what I would call this, but with that early new age sound. A lot of synthesizers, the drumming is incredible. You know, they put like an echoplex or some sort of heavily reverberated effect on it, giving it a very much out there feel to it. You can see here on the back, it says a cosmic rock relaxation creation. Maurice and Walter present Moolah. And this is an original copy, Sometime, maybe somewhere 7-8 years ago, on eBay, maybe even, could have been before Discogs, I don't know. I don't remember. I know it was off eBay. Someone had a bunch of sealed originals, and they were up for, I think, $50 or $60, and that's when I got this. And I think some have inserts, mine does not, but I don't know if that's true. But yeah, he was selling off sealed copies, and I got one. I'm glad I did. They're definitely selling for a little more now. There are bootlegs of this, so I was kind of concerned that it was boot, but it's not. It's just, yeah, if you love experimental rock, private issue new age, or krautrock, this Moolah record is a stunner. I feel like some people find it to be overrated, and I just can't disagree anymore. It's absolutely breathtaking to me every time. I just think it combines all the best of those sounds in the greatest way, and it's a shame they didn't do anything more. But it's 1974 on the Atman label, or Atman Music. Mainly instrumental, as I said. There's a little bit of chanting. And there's a cool picture of them all insert here, too. It's the only thing that there is, really, of them. So, there it is, number 17, Moolah. All right, number 16. Just like the street gonna be. Band most of you should know, Simply Saucer out of Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. This is the original pressing from 1989. I'll explain why 1989. On the Mole Sound label. Where's the insert? Here's the insert. The insert has a description of what's happening. Simply Saucer, Hamilton. So it was mainly read by Edgar Bro and recorded by Bob Lanois. Yes, Daniel Lanois' brother. And I think Daniel was involved a little bit too. But recorded at least side one of this in 1974 in their basement. This is Cyborgs Revisited. And the first side of this is that live studio recordings. The second side is live, which sometime recorded outside in 1975. So you can see it says Studio 74, Live 75. And this is amazing. It is proto-punk Stooges style, but with psychedelic theremin, I guess it is, and synthesizer. I forget, somewhere I had it written down what synthesizer they're using, but it really combines all those things, garage, psych, proto-punk, and it is amazing, you know? When I first heard this, the song Bulletproof Nothing, I was like, that's a catchy song, and it sounds like something I need to investigate, but all the other songs around it are really what blew me away. Side one of the studio, you have Instant Pleasure, Electro Rock, Nazi Apocalypse, Mole Machine, Bulletproof Nothing. Here come the Cyborgs, which gets cut off, and then on side two, you hear the live edition, rendition, which is the whole thing. So, yeah, if you don't know this one, there is an In the Red reissue, which I have, which gives you more, expands it to a 2LP, and gives you more recordings, more live recordings. The studio stuff is truly the best, you know. It's just like incessant, like they really meld, you know, proto-punk and psychedelia in a perfect way. It's definitely up there with a Debris record as like the finest sort of representation of that. These guys, you know, the only thing they officially released was in 1978, the 45, She's a Dog, which I have, which is very good, but it's almost more like a pre-punk power pop thing. This wasn't released until 1989 on the Mole Sound label, as I said. But that is the first edition of this, because originally it was never released. And I don't know why it didn't come out at all, or why it wasn't released sooner, but I'm glad it did, you know. They've reformed over the last 20 years and are still releasing some music, some more reissues, there's more archival stuff that I have. It's all about this, though. There's various pressings of this, Get Back reissue. The In the Red is the one I would recommend, but this Mole Sound one, see if you can find it. I just can't emphasize how like revelatory this record is in its scope, in its appeal, and its sort of heaviness, and it just like hits on all those measures, hits on all those marks. Edgar Breaux, great songwriter, I think, and subversive even in its some of its material. It's definitely got the Velvet Underground kind of like chug and chugle. I mean, it's certainly a VU influence on this, but adding in that sort of harder edge and that blown out sound and the synthesizer sound is a wonderful thing. So here we go, Simply Saucer, Cyborgs Revisited. I got at number 16. Whoa, let's get to the top 15. But before we do, I'm going to change up the record and play as a tribute to Sublime Media doing a Swedish Psych Countdown. I got to talk about that in another video. I'm going to play Trad Gross Ochstener, Djungens Lag. Moving up to number 15 and the second record by this band. And this one was originally going to be second to the other one. But I have Easter Everywhere by the 13th Floor Elevators at number 15. Yes, I had Psychedelic Sounds of originally first, but I decided that this is truly the stronger record with the songs that we have here. Slip Inside This House. She Lives in a Time of Her Own. The Postures track, misspelled in the first press. Earthquake, Tommy Hall is still doing his jug thing here. I think it's a little bit less. And this is the box set edition that comes with the mono and stereo, as I said, I think last time, maybe digitally sourced. But I just think that the material's slightly stronger on this record. I love this cover. It's basically like a sort of tantric thing, all based on the Tommy Hall's concept about tantric, sort of practice. No hit singles on this. Apparently, Liam Rogers did pour a lot of money into this from the international artist label head, and it just didn't really work out. A lot of resources spent, but wasn't a hit like the first album. A new lineup in some ways, other than Stacey Sutherland, Rocky Erickson, and Tommy Hall. Dan Galindo and Danny Thomas, bass and drums on this. This is the edition gatefold that they put on here. A little more language, a little more fluid. There's longer tracks on here, the sort of stretching out a bit. It's less of a garage rock record, more of a psych record, I think, but still sort of has that psych sound to it, of course. Discovered this one after finding out about the first one. And like, those times as a kid, you're discovering records, but sometimes you just get stuck on that one record and you sort of forget to look and say, hey, what else did this band do? At least that was me. And so I didn't discover this one until years after. I discovered Psychedelic Sounds of in the late 90s, and this one probably took me like 5 years to find this. I don't know why, but you do Bob Dylan on here with Baby Blue, probably not my favorite thing about this, but I just love Slip Inside This House and She Lives in a Time of Her Own. I just think of it about like sort of like, flying in the air, just sort of sailing. Like it just like a very streamlined, beautiful sort of psychedelic rumble. Rocky, about to sort of be put away here, but still very much in his prime, hooting and hollering. They would go on to make a third record, Bull of the Woods, which for a lot of people love that record, maybe more than these first two, because it doesn't have the jug. The jug has its haters. Not me. I'm into the jug. So, 13 Floor Elevators, Easter Everywhere, 1967, Texas Legends, number 15. A little bit of repeats on this. I mean, that's just the way it is. Number 14 is that Agincourt record by John Ferdinando and Peter Howell. Peter Howell would, of course, become part of the BBC Radiophonic Workshop and work on, in that capacity, Doctor Who. This is their 1970 record. The Ithaca record, which I featured last countdown, was a John Ferdinando record. This one is more of a Peter Howell, with vocals by Lee Manilis and John Ferdinando putting in instrumentation to it. And but this one's more has Howell songs on it, and it just includes some of the most beautiful songs ever, really, for me. The song Lisa, on the second side, I think it is, I just think is, like I've talked about, up there with the Beatles in terms of an incredibly well-produced song. This is from 1970, so it precedes the Ithaca record. Again, like all of their stuff, demo recordings, essentially pressed an edition of 99 copies. This is a reproduction of the label. The insert has lyrics, the only lyrics where you can find these lyrics, actually. This is a reproduction of the original label. This is the, like, record, I guess the record collector edition. This one is, I think, the edition to have of this. This has recently been reissued, but I think it's a boot. So this one is authorized. And, yeah, it's got this Marabella, like a song Belle and Sebastian, which they wrote, just incredibly, incredibly catchy. Marabella, pretty mermaid, come alive now with now. You're too far out to sea, so come alive. The whole thing just moves in like a song cycle, sort of, you know, feels like a song cycle. Every track sort of runs into each other, and just beauty upon beauty upon beauty. Agincourt Court Fly Away. The last track, Through the Eyes of a Lifetime, is sort of a sweet, and yeah, it's certainly a whimsical, like this band has a definite whimsical poppy sense to it, but a little bit of prog, progressive sort of, you know, techniques. And incredible songs. Love their voices. The drummer really adds a lot to these songs. This, when it comes to, like, psych folk, which technically is what I would call this, this is the absolute peak for me. For me. This is for me. My list. 1970 Fly Away. I mean, I've talked a lot about this band. I'll link once again to the feature I did on the two songwriters who had various projects. John Ferdinando, Peter Howell. This is Agincourt, the name of the record, Fly Away from 1970. Number 13, a record I've talked about before. You knew when I got it, it was a big acquisition. We're talking about July.
Floating on the air, never seem to care. Worries have they none. See them drift up on the breeze, dandelion's feet.
1968. This is my original that I had gotten last year on Epic. And this is the reissue, I think it was Record Store Day. It's a reproduction of the Major Minor release. It only came out originally in the UK as a mono. In the UK, it was mono only. In the US, it was the stereo copy. I believe there is a mono and a mono promo. I have the stock copy. Tom Newman and what's the second guy in this band? Tom Newman and Peter Cook are the songwriting partnership. Tom Newman would go on to do a whole bunch of other stuff, release his own records, produce. He worked with Mike Oldfield, and he had solo records. They started as the Tomcats, a garage beat group that kind of had some popularity in Spain. And yeah, very much a UK garage group, but they changed their name to July in 68, like a lot of bands were. Oops. And yeah, this is such a great studio psych record. I mean, the way they incorporate this work with the studio into the songs. I mean, My Clown and the best song off his Dandelion Seas is an absolutely incredible composition. But the whole thing has an eerie sort of underground feel to it, but definitely is more pop psych than anything else when it comes to what this band is and what was happening at the time. It was a huge flop, apparently. The major minor label, I forget whose that was, but this was panned and panned hard. And I'm surprised it came out in the US, probably because there was sort of some muscle behind it. But now that UK mono original is exceptionally rare, as is the US. I can't believe I got the price on this that I did. The US original has gotten to be stupid too. So, well, it always was stupid expensive, but it's gotten even more crazy. So, Tom Newman, this barely existed. I don't even know if they ever played live. They did come back together and make a reunited for another album, and there's a demos record which I had but decided not to keep just because I felt like this is what I need. So there is some second life to this group, and Tom Newman sort of the main character that is associated with them. But you know, this record's legendary. I mean, when it comes to pop psych in the UK, you don't do much better than this. You can do a little bit better than this, which we'll talk about, but this gives you, you know, top rate songs, you know, stony production. You know, I love the track on Dandelion Seeds where like the song sort of drops out and it's this little mini suite moves in, and then it sort of fades back into the song, sort of like, you know, like a garagey sort of stone zone. Exceptional record. Yeah, very poppy. Definitely is sort of on the pop psych side of things. So if that scares you off, it's definitely not too like subversive or anything. I won't go through all the songs. They're great. Here's my back of my sleeve. There they are. July. Number 13 in the Psychedelic 100. Man, we're getting high on this list. If you haven't heard this record, check it out. There are reissues available. I don't know what this RSD edition is doing these days, but I'm keeping it for now because it's mono and this is stereo. So. Number 12, two left in this list. Men waiting for a full moon. The hounds and the horsemen chased by the fox. 10,000 words in a cardboard box. Talk about Twink and Think Pink. 1970 originally released in the UK on Polydor, but released here first on Seymour Stein's new label Sire. So it actually came out, even though Twink was a UK artist, it came out here way before the UK. 71 in UK, 70 here. John Alder, drummer with Pretty Things, Deviants, also with the Pink Fairies, associated with Hawkwind. This is the best thing he was ever involved with. It smokes all those bands. The Deviants are good, but this is just... Now, I used to have the Sunbeam original, and this is the Sunbeam second press, which includes an unreleased mono edition. This is, of course, you know, pink vinyl. And this record is so good and screwed up. It's like... You wouldn't think of it to be quite as sort of mysterious and dark as it is, but it is. It's got some towering guitar to it. Song just called Suicide. You get this classic Hypnosis cover here. There is Twink sort of in the wilderness there. 10,000 words in a cardboard box. It's just got such a massive sound to it. And this one does give you a little bit of psych folk too. But just fits it in. This one all, again, sort of like what I talked about before with song cycles, it does feel like that. It just, things come in and out and sort of moves into the next. Very beautifully, wonderfully produced. You know, it's just, it knocks my socks off every time. Tiptoe on the Highest Hill, like his vocals are really good too, I have to say, Twink's vocals on this. There's a whole booklet in this one with a big description. I've come close to buying the Sire original, and yeah, it's just when it comes to psychedelia, psych folk, experimental, this one sort of gives you everything, you know. Twink, think, pink. That's usually what it is with this list, is like, you know, records that sort of touch a little bit on all of the different psychedelic aspects. And as far as where this one first heard this, God, it's hard to remember on this one. I know I said I was going to try to give you more detail, but yeah, I checked it out at some point. I was trying the Sunbeam reissues as they were coming, and this one from the get-go has always been one of my favorites. This one I think will appeal to people who don't necessarily get into a lot of psych. We'll find a lot of it sort of repeats itself. Incredibly stone heavy. It has a definite heaviness to it too. Darkness. There it is. Number 12. Think Pink by Twink, 1970. Alright, last but not least, the third record in this list by Can. Number 11. Iggy Bemyasi, 1972. Right? No, 1973. No, 1972, I was right. This is my German original with the inner sleeve here. On Liberty. I'm sorry, United Artists. What am I saying? This is the first German, and then I still have the reissue, the Mute reissue, which sounds excellent. Fourth album, 1972, features that great song, Vitamin C.
Stay at the corner. She is a ribbon in an out of a tune. Hey, you.
This is Can, sort of, in a way, almost in a down, like, because they had a hit with Spoon, a single, this hit single in a sense, and they had to promote that, and they toured it around a lot with that record, or with that single, and so they went in to record this record, and they didn't have that much material, actually, so they included the single on this record, which I guess they didn't necessarily want to do, but Spoon's a great song, it's fantastic. Vitamin C, I mean, Jackie Liebeseed on that song is just incredible. He's incredible on every track, but apparently Liebeseed and Damo Suzuki were like playing a lot of chess in the studio and sort of wasting, or you know, holding things up a bit and being sort of jokers, but you know, this is when they're really coming into their own and having money to have, you know, the Interspace studio and upgrading the studio and you know, Holda Shukai still sort of producing, but this one definitely is sort of pieced together like a lot of theirs are, but maybe even more so. It doesn't feel that way. It feels so natural. The way the band, and when you see them perform live, it feels that way. Like they really vibe off each other well, and everyone sort of has their moment, but never gets too high above the fray. And yeah, this one I just never get tired of. Iggy Bemyasi. It's the first record I ever heard. A friend of mine, maybe it was even my wife, Angela, who first passed me the CD on this, because a friend of hers recommended it to her. And so the CD is what usually got me going. And with a lot of the records on this list, my favorite ends up being the one I heard first. Is it the best? Well, according to me, it is, but it might not jive with everyone else's opinion, because for me, those are the ones I heard first, and it's the one that sort of got me acclimated. So that's what Iggy Bemyasi is, and it could be the obvious pick, but who gives a shit? I mean, this thing is an essential record, a perfect record. It's a knockout. Instrumentally, you know, it's danceable, it's sort of far out. It's got punch, it's got, you know, Damo Suzuki sort of doing what he does. Great cover, great sleeve. Not have the poster. The poster is very hard to get, but nice to have that insert or the original inner sleeve here. The man that hath no music in himself, nor is not moved with concord of sweet sounds, is fit for treason, stratagems, and spoils. The motions of his spirit are dull as night, and his affections dark as Erebus. Let no such man be trusted. Mark the music, Shakespeare. So there it is, with the track times on this. And yeah, here's the, on the other side, you got your personnel there. Michael Caroli, Damo Suzuki, Jackie Liebesit, Holger Shukai, and Erwin Schmidt. Recording engineer Holger Shukai. Is there a producer listed? No. Right, because they were really self-producing, which is also kind of cool. Yeah, that's the last Can record in this list. Number 11, Iggy Bumyasi. How can you argue with that, right? Yeah, this one would rank really high in my list of favorite records all time. So there it is. Number 11, final record in this part 9 of the Psychedelic 100. So yeah, there it is. I'll put all the relevant links. I post, as you know, like performances and things on these videos. I'll put all the links to sort of the full editions below. All the stuff I've talked about will be below. The list from 100 down to number 21 is down below. So that's it. Part 9, Psychedelic 100. We'll do one more. And I hope you dug this. I hope you've been digging the series. Check out the old ones if you haven't seen those yet. I will be seeing you soon with other videos, other ideas. And this next part, Psychedelic 100, to come within a few weeks. So take care. Hope you enjoyed this one. See ya.